back to the ICC Connect talk show. So we took a short break. So if you're here, again, like, share, comment, because now we're still going to go deeper, where we're going to, you know, we're still in the light of fatherhood and fathers, but we want to talk about, you know, the perception and the issues that are going on in the body of Christ. So if you're here, join us, welcome back. We took a short break, but we are back. So if you're here, again, invite someone. We're back, let someone know that we're back. Okay, Bishop, like I already said, if you're not aware, we are here with our General Overseer, ICC London. We are coming live to you, and we have Bishop Seth Mensah here on our panel, and we are privileged to have this opportunity. So right now we want to discuss the issues that are facing the body of Christ at the moment, in regards to false prophets and false pastors and things like that. So what is a false prophet? Who is a false prophet?
Okay, this is very, very, very good question, and it's some of the things that I'm talking about anywhere I go in Ghana, anywhere I go, I really talk about this. You know, people, and anytime I'm saying this, people think that ICC, we don't believe prophets. If I don't believe prophets, then ICC is a false church. It means I don't believe the gospel, I don't believe the word. I believe 100% that Genesis to Revelation, whatever the Bible has said, I believe the office of a prophet. But problem we are having now that a lot of people are calling themselves prophets, who they are not. For example, when you read the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, he talked about spiritual gifts. Mm-hmm. And the spiritual gifts, he talked about discernment. He talked about prophecy. He talked about word of knowledge. He talked about healing. He talked about so many things. Wisdom. When somebody see a vision, does not mean that you are a prophet. The reason why the gifts are not working in the church is because of this. Because when somebody see a vision today and tell somebody that I saw a vision about you having an accident, and an accident came to pass, then the next day she is a prophetess. Then the next day he is a prophet. Also, God gave you a word of knowledge about what somebody is going through, and you were able to say it, and yet the person confirmed that it's true. I was going through this. All of a sudden, the person said, I'm a prophet. Mm-hmm. And that's the problem we are facing right now. You having vision, you can prophesy. Prophesying does not mean that you are a prophet. You can prophesy. If you read the Bible in the book of Joel chapter 2, it says, on the last days I will pour my spirit upon all flesh. Mm-hmm. And then the young people shall prophesy, and then we, the old men will sleep and have dreams. Those who are prophesying, are they prophets? They are not prophets. So it's this. A prophet can prophesy, but the one who prophesies is not a prophet. But if, for example, you can, especially in this country, if I haven't got a big lancers like D1 or D2 lancers, mm-hmm. I can't drive a van. I can't drive a big van. I have to drive only small car. Yeah. But this, yesterday they call me a driver. They call me a driver. Me being a driver, me being prophesying, that don't mean that I hold an office of a prophet. Mm. So then, who is a prophet? A prophet is an office. Like, as the pastor is an office, as the evangelist is an office, as the teacher is an office, as an apostle is an office. When somebody say, I'm a pastor is the one who take care of the sheep. That's God have defined it. When we say somebody is evangelist, the one who go around, preach the gospel, people give their life to Jesus Christ, doing crusades, going round and round and everything, he's called an evangelist. When you come to an apostle, a one who established churches, he's called an apostle. Today you hear people call himself apostle. He established one church in the corner. He said, I'm an apostle. You know, that's the problem. And then somebody said, I'm a teacher, because he's able to open Genesis chapter 3 and quote it. He said, I'm a teacher. And so it is a prophet. Somebody prophesied today, I'm a prophet. No, a prophet is an office. A prophet simply means a messenger of God. The one that God had given him a specific message to speak. Something to say. A message that God has given to you to say it. Either present, either past, or future. Working with the gift of word of knowledge. That is a prophet. So you seeing a vision today, you prophesy, you having word of knowledge, does not mean that you are a prophet. And right now, I can tell you 95% of so-called prophets are not prophets. Because they stand in the pulpit and preach and pray for people and say, I see you in my, the witches are there and I see you in my dreams. And I know they are not prophets. Why? Prophet is more than that. Prophet is sent for an assignment. The prophet comes in for a purpose. Prophet doesn't mean stay in the church and prophesy, bring your panty, let me bend it, I'm doing this, let me do it. That's not an office of a prophet. It's more than that. Yeah. A prophet comes with a mandate. He comes with the woes. I mean, prophecy comes to exalt, educate, and then comfort. But a prophet is not like that. Whether he's going to exalt you, no. Whether he's going to... No, it doesn't matter. For example, the Bible says that God called Moses... Abraham, a prophet. It was God who chose him as a prophet and called him as a prophet. Let's open the Bible. Where did Abraham prophesy? No. He didn't prophesy, but God himself said, don't touch that prophet's wife. He's a prophet. So the problem we are having now, if you really want to know a prophet, look at the message that he or she is saying, or a prophetess. Do I believe in prophetess? Yes. If I don't believe, I don't believe in the Bible. Do I believe in prophet? Yes. Yeah, you know, if you are in ICC and God called you to be a prophet, we accept you, fine. But we will check the message that you are preaching. The reason I'm passionate for it is this. Jesus said, on the last day, there shall be false prophets. Jesus himself said it. And false Christ.
Yeah.
And they shall deceive many. So the hard work that we are doing, the prophets will come in and deceive them. And we have to talk about it. The word Christ means the anointed. That's what Jesus said. He said, many shall come with false anointing, and they are there.
Yeah.
Right now, whatever miracle you want, they will perform. I mean, we shouldn't follow the miracles, we should follow Christ. And that's why anywhere you go, where the word of God is not preached, but the person is anointed, Jesus said, many on the last day, people will come in the name of me, so-called anointing. Don't chase the anointing. Do that, and God will bless you. If you are able to do those things, I believe that God is going to lift your name up. So I encourage the genuine pastors and the genuine evangelists and genuine gifts to do what God has called you to do. If God has not called you to be a prophet, don't be a prophet, because you are going to be judged as a prophet. I'm going to be judged as a pastor. I'm not going to be judged as a prophet. I'm going to be judged as a pastor.
Yeah.
Because if I have not been to university and you gave me something that I don't know, I'm going to fail the test. And a lot of people are going to fail. And that's why they are telling you, bring this money, bring that, bring that.
So then, in saying that, sorry, I don't mean to cut you, but then how can you identify that someone is a false prophet?
The first prophet is, look at the message they are saying. That's what I'm saying, that they come in with a mandate. He's giving you God's word, a word that based upon the word. If you read a book of, Ezekiel, he says, if anyone prophesy, a prophet comes and prophesy in the name of the Lord. It does not come to pass. The Bible says we should stone him to death. If you are going to do that, we will chase a lot of prophets out from this.
Yeah.
You know, so the point for you to know that this man or this woman is a false prophetess, or this man is, look at the message, look at his fruit. The Bible says, by their fruits we shall know them. The word that is coming out from his mouth, is it charging you? Is it preaching the word? What is his character? What are the prophecies that come out from the prophet? Look at all these things and know that no. For example, one woman from this church went to Ghana, and when we went to Ghana, someone was preaching a nice message. And so she called it, because that time we didn't have church in ICC. So she called the phone and said, I'm going there. When she went there, they said, oh, before you see that man of God, you have to pay that consultation fee. And then he said, no, my pastor said he didn't teach me that, so I'm not going to pay. And then she walked out. For example, if she did not know, she could have gone. And the prophet would just prophesy and tell you. And sometimes this is what they do. They send the I'm not saying God cannot do it. God is God that knows everything. I will never limit God in any form of way. God can do. He's the omnipotent God, the omnipresent God. But these false prophets sometimes send ushers to go to the car park and write car numbers. And then when you come, you are wearing Connect, you are wearing jeans, you have long distance, you park this car number so and so, you are going to have an accident and so leave your car. That's what they do. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's a prophet? That's what God is saying? No. Mm-hmm. God could have said that there's somebody here. Da, da, da. You don't mean to deceive the people to make money.
Yeah.
Let's sit down. Mm-hmm. Go according to the word of God. It's good to be poor and go to heaven than to be rich and go to heaven.
So if you're just joining us, like, share, make people aware that we're on. At the moment, we're talking about, you know, false prophets and false preachers in the body of Christ, people that we see as our spiritual fathers and things like that. So I have a question. So how can we kind of confront those people? When they call us out, do we say, no, we're not coming?
Oh, yeah. I mean, people call me, they want to come and preach here. I say, no. Mm-hmm. They can't come here. You cannot come. You know, you cannot. I won't give you the pulpit. Immediately you give them the pulpit, they use your pulpit to advertise. And then immediately you give the pulpit, meaning that you want your members to accept them. Mm-hmm. So when they call you, you can refuse it. Let me give you an example. There was one man of God who was telling me a story that a prophet went to their church and preaching. And then he called those who are looking for the fruit of the womb. And then some women came, husband and wife came forward. And then she looked at the woman and said, the devil have taken your womb, and he has put in your womb in the sea, and he has put in a big stone on it. Why is he saying that? He's saying that so that you put fear in you, so that you go and see him. And the man who know the word of God said, I reject that. My wife's womb is not under the sea. My wife shall conceive. And behold, within some years, the woman conceived. If the man accepted the woman, I mean, the woman could have not conceived.
Yeah.
Is it a vision? Is it a prophecy that coming from God that your womb has been taken and put under the sea? That's a false. Based upon the messages they are saying, you can just know that it's a false. If you know the word of God, the devil don't know how to swim. He can't put your womb under the sea. He can't swim. The devil cannot swim.
Yeah, but don't you think that, because like I said, you just said that if you know your word, but don't you think that sometimes in the body of Christ, many people don't really know their word, and that's why they are easily...
We have lazy Christians now. If you do Bible studies, how many people come? Any church you go to, be all the big churches, how many people go to Bible studies? They won't go to the Bible studies. Ask them how many people go to miracle revival program. The whole church will go to miracle.
Yeah.
But the miracle comes through the word. The Bible says in the book of Joshua, he said, meditate upon this word, and thou will make thy ways prosperous. Reject the word, and you reject your miracle. So we should seek the word, because they don't know the word of God. That's why they are following them. If you know the word, you won't follow them.
Yeah.
You won't follow them.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to know the word. We need to study. We need to study the word. We need to speak the truth. The pastors also have to speak the truth to the members, so that the members don't follow them. ICC members, they won't follow. Having said that, some people will go and follow them. But the problem is that you have been there several years. They are telling you the same thing, that God will do it, God will do it, God will do it. And God is not doing it. The problem is that they are telling that seeth the Lord. I'm not saying Christians don't face challenges. We all face challenges in life. There's nobody who say that I don't face challenges. We all go through some tough time in life, you know. But if God have not said that he's going to do, I've given word of knowledge that God says he's going to do, and God does it. Because I hear it from God before I speak it. If I haven't heard from God, I'm not going to say it.
Yeah.
If I haven't received the word, I'm not going to please people. Sometimes we want to please people. And this have caused a lot of ministers to go astray.
Because, that is very true. A lot of people do things to please. They say things that the members want to hear, not necessarily what will benefit them.
Exactly.
Yeah. So what would your advice be for someone who believes that they have the gifts of prophecy? And how can they...
If you are in a church, you have the gift of prophecy, prophesy. There's nothing wrong with it. No, understand. Study the word. Prophecy is just speaking the word of God. Speaking the word of encouragement, the word of exhortation, the word of comfort. I'm not talking about the office of a prophet.
Mm-hmm.
A prophet does not come with the words of exhortation or comfort or education. A prophet sometimes comes with a warning word. That's here, that if you don't change your ways, you are going to die. If you don't repent, you are going to die. This is the word of a prophet. Or God saying that tomorrow by this time, there's going to be enough food. That tomorrow, yes, by this time, God will do it. That's what it said. Let God answer by fire. Let him be God. And the fire will come down. God said, I should come to your house. Feed me. And then the bread and the oil will never cease. And yes, God said it, so he does it. That's the word of a prophet. That's the word of God. So if you are there, you have a gift of prophecy, prophesy. Prophesy an exhortation to somebody's life. Prophesy a word of edification and a word of comfort to somebody's life. Study the word. Sometimes I prophesy to my own self. I prophesy healing to my own self. I prophesy healing to my people's life. And when you prophesy, it is the word you are prophesying. So the word of God also said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will not pass away. And he said that, listen, until my word accomplishes its purpose, it will never pass away. And so when you prophesy based upon the word of God, it will surely come to pass. So don't feel shy to prophesy. And when God gives you a piece of prophecy, don't run away and say, I'm going to take... I used to have some pastors here who are ordained them and everything, and one of them was saying that, I don't know what happened, he just wanted to follow a proper life. Somebody was telling me that even now, they don't know whether he's still in the faith or not. We believe it, but we guide you properly so that you, when God calls you as a prophet, you will speak the truth, nothing but the truth.
In regards to someone who, if someone receives a prophecy, how can they work on it to make sure it manifests in their lives? Because, like I said, the prophet just speaks.
Yeah.
But then, is it up to you to kind of protect that prophecy?
Good. There are some prophetic messages that are with conditions. There are some without condition. For example, when Elijah prophesied and said, tomorrow by this time, thus says the Lord, there's going to be enough food in this country. 24 hours miracle. He didn't say that. God said that, okay, all of us have to do this, and when we do this, God is going to bless us. That's why. But it wasn't a conditional prophetic message.
Yeah.
It was a message that said, God said that this. But sometimes God will tell you that you want to do this. If you want to see my glory, then do this, and then I will bless you. And some of them are conditional. There are certain things you don't have to do anything about it, and there are some of it you have to do what God wants you to do before the blessing come to pass.
Mm-hmm.
He told Jonah, go to Nineveh and prophesy or preach to the people. You have to go to Nineveh to preach. If you don't go to Nineveh, the devil will meet you at the way. So there are some messages that come, and that's why my problem is, if God have not said it, thou shalt not say that says the Lord.
Yeah.
Because immediately you gave me the false hope that God said that, and I know my God is not the man to lie. Then I relax.
Yeah.
Because God has said it, and surely it has surely come to pass. Have God said it, and he's not going to do it. That's what the Bible says. If God has said it, then God have to do it. So learn. That's why even in the Bible we have a school of prophets. You have a school of prophets. So sometimes God will give you the prophetic message, but learn the ethics of it. There are some messages. God will give me a word for you. And sometimes that word that I have to give it to you, I don't have to give it to you in front of all the members.
Yeah.
I don't have to. But if I don't know it, I want people to know that, oh, Pastor said, I'm so spiritual. And I call you, sister, when you are coming today, this happened to you.
Yeah.
And then people will clap and they'll call you, oh, prophet number one, Gito.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a demonic act. You are looking for fame from people. You know, men can heal you and they can bring you back down. Let God lift you up. And you continue to lift up. So if God have not said it, don't say God have said it.
So in regards to prophecies, does it come with some sort of time frame? Because you know sometimes people prophesy and be like,
oh, you're
great. But when is that greatness coming?
I mean, if God speak to you and tell you are going to uni, and this one you are going to be, I'm going to bless you. That's not mean that you have to stop going to uni. Because you heard a prophecy that God said he's going to bless you. God is saying that as you are going to the uni, this is what is going to come out of what you are doing. So unless you finish the uni, you know, if you are learning to be a medical doctor, you are in uni, and somebody come or you go to church and pastor do call you and say, I see that God have lifted you up and you are going to be a medical doctor. And all of a sudden, you said, oh, my pastor has prophesied that I'm going to be a medical doctor. So you stop going to the medical school.
Yeah.
And then 2 years later, you apply to the Royal Free Hospital and say, I'm a medical doctor. What did you attend? You call whatever. Did you finish? He said, no. Why? My pastor told me I'm going to be a medical doctor. They will ask you, are you right? Are you out of work? So there are the prophetic messages that are coming. Some of them, they are time frame. There are certain things you have to do to bring it to pass.
Yeah.
If you don't do it, it's not going to come. That's other conditional ones. But without the conditional one, whether you do it or you don't do it, God will do what he says he's going to do. Mm-hmm. God will do it.
No, it's powerful. So, because, you know, there's sometimes there are people who get, like you said, get a prophecy, you know, that maybe you'll be a pastor or you'll be a worker of the kingdom, and then they just stop what
they're
doing.
They stop whatever they are doing. They are not going to school.
Yeah.
They don't want to work. If you go to Africa, he's there. You want to be a pastor. He's a very lazy pastor. He doesn't want to work.
Yeah.
You know, or you have five members and you want to be a full-time pastor and he doesn't want to do anything. And we have it in the body of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
It does not mean that God has not called you. When God called me, you know, I was pastor in Ghana. When I came here, I went to Bible school here. And then when I was in the Bible school, I was working in Kentucky Fried Chicken. I was working. Does it decrease me? No. No, I don't have to do devious means to get money. Go to the people and take money. And I didn't do that. I was working when the time was right.
Mm-hmm.
I went to the full-time ministry. And that's how it is. Mm-hmm. So doing what you are doing will not decrease the anointing or will not decrease or will not destroy the purpose of God. Do what you are doing when the time is right. He says in his own time, he made all things what? Beautiful. That's what we have to do.
That's powerful. So like I said, we're here talking about the issues that we are facing in the body of Christ in regards to the people that we see as our spiritual fathers. Are they really, truly our spiritual fathers sent by God? So I just want to ask, so how can we, you know, better ourselves? You know, what is your advice on to Christians that may have realized that, you know, their spiritual fathers may not be what they thought they were because now they know the word for themselves?
Oh, yeah. My advice to you is that the Bible says, the word of God is a light unto us, a light unto our feet.
Mm-hmm.
If where you are, the light is not there, the word is not there, but you have chosen the person to be your spiritual dad or your spiritual mom, but the advice you are getting is contrary to the Bible you are studying, to the Bible you are reading. Please run away from there. Run away from there. Mm-hmm. Go to a place where you get the solid word, the word that is not diluted, the word that comes from God. You know, if you don't do that, you are going to miss it.
Mm-hmm.
So let's try and do those things. And when we do those things, it's going to help us. If you don't do those things, you are going to miss it. Don't ever make a covenant with somebody and say that you are going to be my spiritual father forever. You are going to be my spiritual mother forever.
Yeah.
I don't think we have to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And when you are in the church, and the church, if you are in ICC, all of you, all the youth, you are in ICC, and all of a sudden, we bring a doctrine. And that doctrine is not something that is of the word. Run away from ICC and go to different church that the doctrine is based upon the pure word of God.
Mm-hmm.
We are not saying that because you are believing in ICC, you are a member of ICC, all of a sudden we will stand here one day and we say, Jesus is not the way. Now, Pastor Seth is the way, the truth, and the life. And when you come to me, I will bless you. And all of you are following me. It means that you have lost your mind.
Mm-hmm.
You have lost your mind.
So in that sense, would you confront the pastor? Would you say, Pastor, what you said, it's not biblical? Or would you just leave?
No, sometimes you do it, you can do it rightly. You go to the pastor and say, Pastor, today you said something that, I mean, it's bothering my mind. He said, what? He said, you said it. Maybe you did not really understand it the way you want to explain it.
Mm.
And so when you go to, maybe he was explaining to you better. But if he said, yeah, what I said is what I said. I'm now the way, the truth, and the life. You tell the pastor, Father, Pastor, thank you for all the help you are helping me. But when I was coming here, I thought Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. So if you are now the way and the truth and the life, then may God bless you. I'm going away.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I will encourage everyone who go to church, everyone who have accepted Jesus Christ as his or a Lord and personal Savior, please let Jesus be the center of everything that you do. If Jesus is not in the center of the church, if Jesus is not in the center of the pastor's life, if Jesus is not in the center of whatever you are doing, you say, look unto Jesus, the altar and the finish of your faith. If it's not Jesus, please run away from the place. Go to a place where Jesus is lifted up.
Yeah.
Because he said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men to myself. So let Jesus be lifted up.
Let Jesus be lifted up. That is powerful. That is powerful. I know you've said that, but what are your last remarks in regards to this topic?
I mean, what we are saying today, as you said it, we want to say Happy Father's Day to all the fathers. No matter your mistake, you are a father. No matter what you are going through, you are a father. I'm applauding you. You brought somebody, whether you are biological father or not biological father. So far as you are a father, may God richly bless you. But what I'm trying to say is speak blessing to your children's life. And as you are speaking blessing to your children's life, your children will be what God has called them to be. As a spiritual fathers, let's help all the young ministers, those who are coming, the youth that are coming, to be where God wants them to be. Doing that, we will see the glory of God in our life. May God bless you.
Thank you so much. Like I said, thank you so much for honoring our invitation.
Amen. Thank you too.
I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did.
I enjoy it. I'm learning a lot of things from you.
Yeah.
I enjoy it.
Thank you. So if you've tuned in, thank you so much for tuning in. This is brought to you by the Connect team. Like I said in the previous one, if you want to support this department, this ministry, and this talk show, feel free to private message us on Facebook or on all our social media, any of our social media platforms, and we will explain to you how you can do that, so that we can bring better quality and, you know, different people onto this talk show. I also want to make you aware that, you know, ICC are in different places. We have a branch in Harlow, we have a branch in Northampton, we have a branch in Luton, and we have the headquarters here in London. So please, please, if you're not in a church, and you're looking for a place to worship, then please check out our social media, and look into the comments. We'll have our addresses and our details, and church services times right on there. So before I wrap it up, I want to make it aware to stay connected on all our social media platforms, and follow us where we on Sundays, and on all the services are streamed live on Facebook or on YouTube. Bishop, before we go, we just want to give you a small token of appreciation for coming onto our
thank
show.
Thank you.
I mean, we cannot, you know, box our appreciation.
No, I'm honored. I'm happy to be on your platform. We are learning a lot from you.
Yeah.
Things that we didn't know, you know it now. So we are learning from you.
Well, thank you for joining
Amen.
Us.
Thank you.
And thank you.
God bless you. I'm very grateful.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining here. If someone you invited wasn't able to come, make sure you share the video. It's on our Facebook, so share it and let the people around you be blessed, and let their, you know, eyes be opened and enlightened. Thank you for joining us, and remember, stay connected.